very little correlation between political parties, elections, and in fact, in the last four general elections, 1999, 2004, 2009, and 2014, we've actually seen very marginal movement, 1 month pre-elections and phase one and post-elections verdict, very much, except for a 22% run-up in the 2009. And 2014, I believe there was a 10% meltdown. 2004, there was a 10% meltdown after the verdict when Manmohan Singh came in. And as I said, post-election verdict, whoever comes, you're not going to see a big runaway, a one-way street. There are lots of other factors. You mentioned the risks which are there. Other than election, I've already said election, I don't see as a risk. We are actually looking at, as I said, earnings, the economy on the backdrop of lower interest rates, lower inflation rate, a stable rupee and a stable oil price. We should see earnings pick up, and as long as GDP growth rates remain at 7% plus, we've seen, you'll see an impact of structural reforms continuing, any structural adjustment. Like you had GST, which was a big announcement, which is now factoring in and stabilizing the what's going to happen in those fronts. And on the global front, we are not an island, we are not independent of the, so whatever happens worldwide, which is significant, will impact and lead into India. So we are looking at both economic and geopolitical factors globally, which could cause things. So this is where we are placed right now. So the caution flags are up, though there is also excitement, I won't call it euphoria. Clearly, others, those who've got debt leverage. You see, interest is not an appropriation of profits. Dividend is. Interest has to be paid. So you will see companies which are in debt, which have got a high debt component, unless it's the sector dynamics like power or whatever, they would be under pressure on margins, on performance, and therefore pressure on paying their EMIs. And defaults would be, we've already seen that happening, the power sector, we've seen the solar sector, you've seen Suzlon. Wealth destruction is simply immense. And promoters are forced to pledge their shares and then top them up, and one problem leads to the other. So vulnerabilities, look for companies, simply stay away from companies which have got a debt exposure, which is fairly huge and are going to face profitability compression, you know, on their margins, and the whole set of these sectors. I'm seeing value in the hospitality industry. I'm seeing value in the banking industry, select pockets. I'm seeing value, as I said, in the disruptive sector, in the AIF, actually the startups. I'm seeing some great entrepreneurial skills coming, entrepreneurship, which happened in 1990s and modern reforms came, and I'm seeing that happening, driven by technology, you know, the technological drive. So I'm seeing a lot of pockets, real estate, selected pockets, you can infra, selected pockets. I'm seeing a technology, selected pockets. I'm seeing a lot of great value in a lot of companies, then PSUs, some of them, you'll be surprised when I say PSUs, they say, oh, Gaurav, they never go up. I would beg to differ, you know, NBCC, when it came out. So I'll give you a hint here, you know. Look at the PSUs that have come out in the last 2 years with IPOs, even as recently as last week. I think let's stop there on the hint. The company is Bombay Dyeing. I have conviction on it. Had issues, several issues, corporate, but you have a company whose market cap is around 3,000 crores, who's got development value of their land is around 30,000 crores in Mumbai, which will break out in the next six, seven years. It's got land, forget the textiles and polyester, we're not buying it for that. So it's Bombay Living, not Bombay Dyeing. You know, Bombay Realty is the story actually. It's got the whole group, if you go back annual reports of 10 years, you'll find they announced 10,000 when they wanted to monetize, like a lot of companies who had land in Bombay. They said, Mumbai, it's 10,000 acres we have in our group, 700 acres in Mumbai, 70 acres in Bombay Dyeing. So they've already started developing that. You've seen Island City Center. So over the next 6 to 7 years, you'll see all this breaking into the balance sheet. So just put yourself with a capital of just 41 crores, 2 rupees, 21 crore shares. If your net worth just climbs to 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 crores over the next, you know, just see what your book values would be and see what your price would go up to. So what's the downside risk on this? You know, do you own due diligence? I'm not going to, because where Wadia's is, Wari is. And one more cushion. Do you know that they own 75 lakh shares out of Bombay Burma? which is a Wadia Group company, which in turn holds 50.70% of through associated through other wholly owned subsidiaries in Britannia, which has a market cap of 75,000 crores plus at around 3,000 rupees. So you can say about 38 to 40,000 crores is owned by Bombay Burma. If Wadia has had to close down everything and monetize at the market price, you'll get 40,000 crores coming into Bombay Burma from their investment in Britannia.